Hi, I'm Marcus Schoon, and this is my good friend Al Ayoub, and this is the electric bassoon.
Thank you.
Fiesta by Chick Corea, and it had a little tag in front. It's the Rodrigo Guitar Concerto de Aranjuez. And we're here today to talk about and demonstrate the sonic capabilities of the electric bassoon. Yeah, and mainly with the bassoon is it's not a very loud instrument. It wants to be, but it just physically, acoustically, you can't really push the bassoon that loud. And so, unfortunately, if we want to play with louder instruments, we have to have a way to amplify. So the main purpose of electrifying the bassoon is simply to make it louder. And the best way I found is with this little pickup mic, and it goes onto the vocal through a brass adapter, and that goes into a preamp. The preamp just boosting this signal, making it a little stronger. That could go right into a speaker if you want. I have mine running directly into a bunch of electronic devices here, which I'm going to introduce to you as we go along. The next tune is called Blackbird by Lennon and McCartney. It's a beautiful tune that shows off, I think, this combination of instruments really well. Jazz standard by Henry Mancini. This is called The Days of Wine and Roses.
Mm-hmm.
so that was Days of Wine and Roses. Next tune we're going to do demonstrates a little bit about some of the more electronics that we have. So if you look at the, this basically the layout I have here by my feet is called a pedal board, and it has a bunch of different boxes on it, and these mostly are digital effects. So the effect we're going to use for Chameleon, I can take the, this is called a Digitech Whammy, and what it does, I can turn it on at a lower, at an octave. So you can hear that octave lower. So it gives me a little bit of a bass sound. The other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to, this is called a Line 6 HX Stomp, and I'm going to change the setting here to give me a little bit more fuzz on the sound. So this is kind of a digital creation, recreation of what guitar players used to do, which is basically overload their amplifiers to create distortion, right, Al?
Yeah, a tube fell out of an amplifier.
That's all right, so this is a distorted sound. So that's the fuzz. Another effect that I like to use is called, on this harmonizer, it's called an S-bend. So it sounds like this. So that's what we're playing with. And you can hear various effects like that. Also, we're using a looper. A looper just takes a line and it creates a track that just plays over and over. And then we also have a drum machine running on this. So lots of little things happening. This is Herbie Hancock Chameleon.
Thank you.
So the next thing we're going to do is we are going to the desecration of Bolero. So this is going to use the looper. It's going to use the harmonizer, and it's going to use some of the fuzz effects. So I think what you'll like about this is you know the tune. I'm just setting this to stop there. No. There. Okay. So again, using the looper, we're going to attempt to play Bolero. Thank you. Last piece, and this is a Brecker Brothers tune written by Randy Brecker. This is called Some Skunk Funk, and we're gonna try it.
Thank you. Performance. That's actually the first time I've heard it straight through, and it's really, thanks so much to both of you guys for doing this. Marcus with us here?
Yep. Can you hear me?
Great. Yeah, Marcus has been having internet problems, so yeah, you look and sound great, so thank you so much for doing that. So for those of you who don't know Marcus, didn't read have a chance to read the program notes that we sent out, Marcus is a bassoon player and a contrabassoon player and a saxophone player and does all of those really, really well. So let's start with the instrument itself, Marcus. A couple of people wrote in, tell us a little bit about that bassoon. Was that the bassoon you play in the DSO?
Well, it's a Fox, it's a certain kind of a plastic bassoon, actually. And I like that bassoon because it's not affected by humidity or temperature or the weather. And then I don't have to worry about taking my, several thousands of dollars heckle bassoon to a nightclub and get it knocked over. So that's the primary reason for having that thing. But a funny story, actually, when we went to China, you weren't supposed to have ivory taken back and forth. And this one bassoon actually has an ivory bell that was put on, long, long time ago. And, there's trouble bringing ivory back and forth. So that's why I had the plastic bassoon. I took that to the China tour. They don't allow ivory anymore on bassoons, but this bassoon's old enough that it was grandfathered in on that.
So if you were to play the two bassoons next to each other, would any of us be able to tell the difference?
It's a pretty good plastic bassoon, but it doesn't sound like a heckle. So, but when you run it through all the electronics, it really doesn't matter.
Yeah, right.
Because you're distorting the sound anyway. So,
yeah.
But it is a good one. I played a lot of plastic bassoons, and this one really has a great sound and feel to it. So it's just a very unusual.
You could do this on the heckle bassoon. You just choose to do it on this one. Yeah.
Yep, right, absolutely.
Cool. And tell me a little bit about the music. I mean, you can't go down to, the local music store and pick up all these arrangements for electric bassoon and guitar. I mean, where are those all coming from?
So, Al and I both select pieces that we enjoy playing. And then I've selected pieces that I think really show off the instrument really well. And also you notice there's a variety of sounds and jazz styles, and so that's another thing I try to do. And, we do all the arranging and everything. So it's all about, it's all one thing that's really nice about a duo is you have a lot more freedom, and an orchestra playing is great. Don't get me, love orchestra playing, but you are part of this kind of setup. You're out there.
So I've known you for a number of years. Mostly I met you when you played on stage at Too Hot to Handle. And you're such a, you play so beautifully in so many different styles. I'm wondering when you wake up in the morning and you want to practice, where do you go to first?
Whatever gig is like that week, which is great. Actually, I've been very fortunate to have to be called for so many different things, and I have the time to just get it together, to sit with it. Either it's Mahler on the mandolin or Hendrix on the guitar, certainly with Marcus, it's all over the map. You know, it's pretty eclectic mix of music, you know. So, to a certain extent, to gain the consistency that you would get if you were just playing one instrument and one note and really focusing on that, I can get a little bit diffused about that. And I have to reel myself in, basically, to make sure that I'm covering the bases, you know, and just not tangentializing, because, you know, I can do that a lot. But, yeah. You know, there's basic threads, too, with all musics. You know, there's a baseline of what we all need to be able to do as horn players, you know, especially wind players. Long tones are very important. You know, it doesn't matter what style you're playing in. You know, articulation exercises on the guitar, finger style versus pick style, that, you know, spans all sorts of genres of music, you know, and simple creating exercises that, you know, fuel the development of just playing the instrument in general.
Yes,
usually want to do.
So the point here is you got to be good in a bunch of different styles, right? Marcus is a little weird because Marcus has the skills that Marcus showed us today are not the same skills that they're not the skills that got him a job in the DSO, right? I mean, being a good bassoon player is being a good bassoon player, but there's a lot more here than that. But your life is much more all over the place in a way. I wondered if you could give us a quick hit maybe of playing the same tune, a brief hit of something, and playing it in a few different styles that the audience might get.
Let's check it out. Now, I remember actually, and you know, rest his soul, Matt Michaels, you know, great jazz pianist, arranger, instructor, professor at Wayne State, said, you know, anymore to all of us that we're in, you know, popular styles of music, so to speak. He said, you really have to be conversant in more than one or two bags, like, and be convincing, or you're just not going to be able to stay in it long enough to make a living, you know. And I took them to heart for sure. So, you know, I mean, it's great if you become the Earl Clue or the Jimi Hendrix or whatever it is, and you do your thing, and it's like people hire you to do that thing. You know, there's a give and take with that, but you know, I just I love playing, so it's really it comes, you know. So let's see what comes out of this. Change, so the nylon string. I have this beast of an instrument that happened to be sitting upstairs, and Thank you.
Amazing. For those of you who don't know what Al was riffing on the theme from the Stravinsky piece called The Firebird, which has a warm spot in the heart of every brass player in the world. Thanks so much for doing that for us, Al. I want to go back to Marcus, see if we can get Marcus.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. Okay. Great. I think you're playing a little excerpt for us for a second. I thought it would be interesting to hear Marcus, who plays both the bassoon and the contrabassoon. You ever play the electric contrabassoon, Marcus?
I have, yes, but never in public.
Why did I know that's the answer? Why don't you play something on both instruments so people can hear the characteristics?
So this is great grandfather.
I'm hoping that the internet, we got about a third of the notes, but it gave us enough people an idea of what the difference in the sound is. If you don't know Marcus, this is an excerpt from Peter and the Wolf, right? Which I've heard Marcus play many, many times so beautifully. We're sort of getting to the end of our time. I did want to say thanks to all of you for coming, and to Al and to Marcus for doing this for us. What a great, great program, guys. Thanks so much for bringing that to us, a nice, light, interesting evening at a time when we need things that are nice, light, and interesting. I'm going to invite everybody here to come to our next one of these Night Notes concerts. Is on October the 30th here with our trumpet player Dave Ammer, the trombonist David Jackson, and a wonderful organist named James Kibbe, who's a star in the University of Michigan faculty. Also, if you're interested, we have on the 21st of October, our sister organization, the Great Lakes Chamber Music Festival, has a vignette with the wonderful violinist named Cindy Wu, who's probably 4 feet 11 of solid energy, and incredibly great, talented young woman. So please join us for those. To thank our sponsors who made this possible, and Margaret and Jeff for sponsoring Marcus, and for all of you for joining us and taking this musical journey with us. We'll look forward to seeing you soon. And thanks, guys, again. It was just great. Thanks so much. I enjoyed every minute of it.
Thank you.
Right on. Thanks, Maury. Thanks, Marcus. You're the best.
Thanks, guys. Good night.